express his distress. There are similar sentiments expressed by everyone who has said anything at all. The Secret Service, which is charged with protecting the president, physically protecting him, is a plainclothes civilian arm of the United States Treasury, which is just next door to the White House, to the left of the picture you're seeing. They are the husky, muscular young men you see in the news pictures. When the president's motorcade is moving at slow speed in a street or a parade, they usually walk along or run along beside it. They are aware that it is impossible. You see a crowd is gathering across the street. That's Lafayette Park, facing the front entrance to the White House. A crowd is gathered over there for no particular reason, because there is nothing anybody can do. But crowds usually do gather there in moments of crisis. That is, of course, the White House flag at half-staff, lowered as soon as the news came. The Secret Service tries to guard him as best it can, very often by keeping their own bodies in line of any weapon that may be aimed at the president. But obviously, they can't cover every window or every tree or every manhole, and they rely primarily on the decency and the good sense of the American people. That, again, is NBC's live television camera on the White House lawn, looking through the iron picket fence across Pennsylvania Avenue to Lafayette Park, named for the Marquis de Lafayette, whose statue is there, and people are beginning to gather there. These are the grounds of the White House, the West Executive Wing, where the President's office is, and where a few minutes ago George Reedy, who is a close associate of Lyndon Johnson, arrived. Didn't say anything, but we assume he came to help make arrangements for the changeover of administration. We don't know specifically yet that Lyndon Johnson has been sworn in, has officially taken the oath, but whether or not he has, he soon will, and whether or not he has, he's president anyway, because that's how the Constitution spells it out. He will, of course, serve out the remainder of Mr. Kennedy's term until January of 64. Beyond that, we don't know. That is about all the detail we have here at the moment, Frank. So we'll switch back to New York for any further details you may have from Dallas or elsewhere.
Say only this, David, that we are still in touch with Dallas, and as we are with you there in Washington, and very shortly, of course, the emphasis of one part of the story will shift from Dallas back to Washington. It is being anticipated that the president's body is being flown back to the nation's capital, perhaps even now, and that is where we expect President Johnson to officially be sworn in. We are anxious, of course, for further information on the quest for the assassin. We do not know whether the actual assassin has been placed under arrest yet or not. We've had stories that one, perhaps two persons have been placed under arrest in Texas, and we have had stories within the past half hour that a Secret Service man as well as a Dallas policeman were killed in a shooting incident sometime after the president had been assassinated. The assumption here would be that the two shootings are connected, but it's not necessarily true. So in very short order, the story will shift to Washington for the formalities there. We'll remain in Dallas for the search for the assassins there, and we will keep our team standing by in both areas to bring you the developments as soon as we have them.
Yes, there is this too, detail on Mrs. Kennedy following the assassination of her husband, the president. Mrs. Kennedy and the president's body were escorted from the emergency entrance of Parkland Memorial Hospital in Dallas by two motorcycle officers. It is said that Mrs. Kennedy walked out the back door of the emergency entrance as the president's body was being taken out. She walked slowly. She looked around her in what is described as a dazed manner and appeared to be in a state of shock. Those who saw her enter the hospital an hour and a half earlier said she had not been hysterical, but in spite of the tremendous experience she had undergone and was undergoing, she had managed to control herself and keep her head. There is this ironic note. The main body of the reporters who daily cover the president apparently did not know that he had lost his life until they got to the destination which the motorcade was headed for, the trademark where the president had been scheduled to make a speech this afternoon. As Robert McNeil has pointed out, he was in the first press bus riding behind the president, and that was three cars behind the president's car. But the main body of the White House reporters was at the rear of the motorcade. They were riding in two buses, and there were many of them who did not know of the shooting until they got to the downtown Trademark in Dallas, and there they found out their first hard news of what had happened, although they did have some idea of what was going on when they saw the motorcade start to fall apart and Dallas police and Secret Service men start to take off in all directions. We are told now that President Kennedy's body will arrive at Andrews Air Force Base at 5:30 this afternoon, Washington time.
About a little less than 2 hours from now, Bill.
Just about 2 hours, yes. Reaction from overseas, the first point we are able to call in right now, our correspondent in Rome, Irving Arlovini.
Shock and grief are the reactions in Italy, where President Kennedy was enormously popular. Italian President Segni immediately sent an aide to the American embassy to express his sympathy. President Segni called President Kennedy's death a great loss to humanity. Pope Paul is preparing a radiogram, which is expected to be ready within an hour. Italian radio and television made the announcement of the president's death and then went off the air except for solemn music. Cardinal Spellman and other American bishops in Rome for the Ecumenical Council expressed shock. Cardinal Spellman said that he is saying rosary for President Kennedy now. Irving R. Levine, NBC News, Rome.
There is the first overseas point we have called in to bring you a reaction to the assassination of President Kennedy, which took place in Dallas, Texas this afternoon. Frank McGee is in touch with Robert McNeil.
Let me interrupt
White House correspondent
you,
who was traveling with the president at the time the assassination took place. Here's Frank's conversation with McNeil.
I just wanted to interrupt you to tell you that you are going on the air. You are, in fact, on the air now, so why don't you make the report direct, Bob?
Go right ahead. We can have pictures, Frank, in about 15 minutes.
I see.
The doctors who attended President Kennedy have just reported his condition. The chief attending surgeon at the hospital, Dr. Malcolm Perry, said the president was in critical condition from wounds in the neck and the head when he was brought into the hospital.
Neck and head.
He said it is possible that these were both caused by the same bullet.
I see.
I'll just tell you what the doctor said. He said they immediately attempted resuscitation. The professor of neurosurgery at the hospital, Dr. Clark, was called in, and several other doctors. They arrived, but the president's condition at that time did not allow any sign of resuscitation. He was critically ill and moribund, that is, near death.
Mm-hmm.
They attempted respiration. They gave him oxygen anesthetic. They performed a tracheotomy, that is, making an opening into the neck to assist breathing. They gave him blood and slips and also tests in the tube to remove any possibility of air getting into the pleural space. They attached an electric cardiograph to monitor his heartbeat, but shortly after that, his heart failed, and they tried external massage to produce a heart movement again. This was without any success. They did achieve, for a brief moment, a faint pulse, but the president finally died at 1 o'clock, about 25 minutes after he was brought into the hospital. They said the brain wound in the president's head involved a great loss of blood and a great loss of brain tissue. The brain wound was in the back of his head, slightly to the right, which, Frank, would fit with the picture I gave you earlier.
Yes, ma'am.
Of the president being, having his back to the assailant. Fit this hypothesis that the assailant was in the building I described as true. But this conflicts with the fact that the wound in the neck, the doctors say, was in the front of the neck, just below the Adam's apple. Now, it could have been that there were two bullets. One struck him as he faced the assailant, the other as the car turned the corner. Or perhaps one bullet just struck him from the front in the neck and then went up the brain. In any case, the president never regained consciousness.
The president was unconscious from the moment he was struck.
Right, he was unconscious and near death from that moment.
I see, Bob. And now, we understood, you told us earlier that the president's body had been removed from the hospital. It was a speculation at that time that it was being taken to the airfield.
Yes.
Are you able to confirm that it has gone?
I believe that that is true, that it was reported that it has gone to the airfield to be flown back to Washington.
And
that Lyndon Johnson, the new president, is for the moment remaining here in Dallas.
Do you know where he is at the moment?
I do not know at the moment where he is.
But he is not on his way back to Washington.
No, he is not.
Not as yet. Bob, thank you very much and stand by. We'll be getting in touch with you a moment later.
Thank you, Frank and Bob. There's this news from Dallas. The police department has arrested one man, but in connection with the slaying of a Dallas policeman, it is not yet known whether this man who is under arrest has any connection with the assassination of President Kennedy. Further details now from the scene. We go to station WDAT-TV in Dallas-Fort Worth and newsman Charles Murphy.
Eight film has just arrived in our newsroom from Dallas. This unedited film shows the scene at the crowded Dallas trademark when news of the shooting was announced. Also on the film is a prayer given then for President Kennedy.
Robert McNeil at the hospital, from doctors who treated the president and were able to give specific and clinical details of the wound, indicating that it was a high-powered bullet, like probably a large-caliber bullet, too. We are now going to go to an NBC mobile unit, which is outside the NBC building here in New York, for pictures and sounds of the reaction of citizens of this city to the loss of their president. We go to NBC reporter Jeff Pond.
We're on the street outside the NBC studios in Rockefeller Center. Sir, how did you hear of the president's assassination?
Gentleman came into an office in which I was transacting business and mentioned it to us, and at the time I really wasn't able to believe it. I had to hear it myself, and unfortunately I did very shortly afterwards.
What is your feeling now?
I'm terribly shocked and saddened by it, and I would add angered by it.
Why angered?
I think it was a horrible, senseless thing, and I hope that the rest of the country feels the same way.
Do you think that this assassination somehow reflects a climate of opinion in the country now?
I hope that it doesn't reflect a climate of opinion that is very prevalent in the country today. It certainly obviously reflects an opinion that some people hold. I hope that as an American and the other people as Americans do not generally hold this feeling.
You said some people. Who do you mean by that?
I don't feel expert enough to express an opinion, but the only evidence that I have as to who these people are these ultra-conservative groups that have been distributing literature and spreading hate in Texas, and who attacked Ambassador Stevenson about a week ago.
A little longer than that. Of course, no one knows that these people are indeed responsible.
No, certainly not.
Thank you, sir. Ma'am, what was your reaction?
I was very shocked and saddened by the president's death. I was getting some eyeglasses fitted when I first heard about it, and then I was riding on a bus when they finally told me he was dead.
Do you find it difficult to believe even now?
I really do. I really find it difficult to believe now.
The president was in Dallas, which is, of course, part of the South. Do you think that somehow his racial policies are in any way connected with this?
That's the first thing I thought of when I heard about it, yes. I thought that probably some segregationist crackpot or something. Just they had it all planned out, and I really believe that his blood will be on their hands forever, yes.
Thank you. How about you, sir? Do you believe it even now?
This is the first time in my life I'm honestly saying I'm not proud to be an American. Right now I'm serving in the armed forces, and I'm just home on leave, and it's an understatement to say it was a shock. I at first did not believe it, and I have trouble believing it now. I just don't think it reflects the thinking of most people. As was stated before, I think it's a small minority, and it's just an unfortunate day for the United States that this can happen. This is something you do read in history books and just never want to believe that can happen when you're living.
Do you think this in some way reflects on the security arrangements that the Secret Service...
There are random samplings, what are called man-in-the-street interviews, people here in New York City, their reactions to the loss of the President of the United States, John F. Kennedy, who died approximately an hour and 45 minutes ago in Parkland Hospital in Dallas, Texas, after being fatally wounded by a sniper. Developments in the nation's capital, reported now by NBC's David Brinkley in Washington.
Bill, we've reported this before, but we will report again that the President's body is expected to arrive at Andrews Air Force Base, a few miles outside of Washington, at about 5:30 Washington time, which is about an hour and 40 minutes from now. The church bells all over town are ringing. We're told that people are standing on street corners crying openly and freely. NBC's Robert Abernathy reports from Andrews Base that the base commander says the president's body, again, will be arriving at 5:30. He also says that Senator Edward Kennedy and his sister, Mrs. Shriver, who was Eunice Kennedy, have just taken off by jet for Otis Air Force Base in Massachusetts. We assume, then, they are going to their home state to join their mother, father, and other members of the Kennedy family. We also are told that military officers who have the job of arranging state funerals are at the White House now and presumably making the plans. Mr. Kennedy is the first president to die in office since the Defense Department was set up and these arrangements were made. And I think there is no set standard ritual to be followed, so to some extent it will have to be made up. Presumably the Army will be in charge of the arrangements, as it always has been, and it has, of course, caissons and ceremonial horses at Fort Myer, Virginia, which is nearby, along with honor guards of troops who presumably will be used. That is about all we have here at the moment. Richard Valeriani of NBC News is at the White House, as is our mobile unit with a live picture, so we'll switch there and see what's happened. Richard?
The American flag atop the White House here in Washington has been lowered to half-mast. It came down shortly afterward. It was confirmation of the president's death in Dallas. In the White House itself, the president's two children are still there, Caroline and John Jr. We do not know yet if they have been informed of their father's death. We don't know either if there are any of the cabinet members here right now. The two ranking members of the presidential staff were Ted Sorensen and McGeorge Bundy, two of the president's aides. The picture of the flag flying at half-mast, the scene through the trees stripped of their leaves, captures the mood of grimness here at the White House. Outside in front of the White House, crowds have begun to gather, waiting for, they probably don't know quite what, perhaps looking for some visual confirmation of what they and everybody else find so hard to believe, that the president is indeed dead, the victim of an assassin's bullet in Dallas. Police have roped off one side of Pennsylvania Avenue. They are allowing pedestrians to walk in front of the White House, but not to congregate there. Extra police details have been sent and have to contain the crowds outside the White House and to surround the White House on all sides. Traffic is moving normally and there are no other changes. We are also told that an assistant to Vice President Lyndon Johnson has also arrived at the White House for George Reedy. There is not a great deal of hard information coming from the White House press office. The first word that was received there was from a reporter who was asking for permission to enter. First word of the fact that the president was shot. The mood in there, too, is one of just utter shock, utter disbelief. The White House press office is jammed with reporters waiting for some bits of information, waiting for any kind of word on what is going to happen next. To repeat, most of the news from here is being received from Dallas. There is no late information on what the next developments will be. The crowds are still gathering outside the front of the White House, across Pennsylvania Avenue. The weather in Washington is gray, rather unseasonably warm, slight chill in the air. People here, as people must be all over the country, walking around with looks of stunned disbelief on their faces. This is Richard Valeriani, NBC News, at the White House in Washington.
Here in Washington, Senator Goldwater of Arizona, Barry Goldwater, who is the man regarded, or was the man regarded, as most likely to oppose President Kennedy in an effort to take the presidency away from him in the election next year, has issued a statement in which he says that it is most shocking and dreadful that a thing like this could happen in a free country. The president's death, Senator Goldwater said, is a profound loss to the nation and to the free world. He and I were personal friends. It is also a great loss to me. Mrs. Goldwater and I offer our heartfelt sympathy to Mrs. Kennedy and to the president's family. He has canceled the political appearance he was going to make last night in Grand Rapids, going to make tomorrow night in Grand Rapids. He reflects really the feeling that is prevalent here on both sides of the aisle in Congress. Feeling of great personal bereavement, feeling of loss, feeling of shock. I think back to the night of the convention in 1960, when Vice President Lyndon Johnson accepted the nomination. Governor John Connally was then the floor manager for Lyndon Johnson, and was the man who was always his closest assistant in all of his political campaign. That is Governor Connally of Texas, who now lies wounded in a hospital in Dallas. About 2 o'clock in the morning, when there was much talk that Lyndon Johnson would be offered the vice presidential nomination, John Connally told me that he was positive he would never accept it. I had talked earlier to the late speaker, to Sam Rayburn. He told me, too, that Lyndon Johnson would never accept the vice presidency, would never give up the job of Senate Majority Leader to take it. And I bet John Connally then $50 that Lyndon Johnson would take the vice presidential nomination. And at 2 o'clock that morning, John Connally made that bet with me, really positive that his very close friend, Lyndon Johnson, would not accept. This, I suppose, is the way that history is made. Had Lyndon Johnson not accepted it, he, of course, would not be president of the United States today. No one could ever have believed or dreamed that a president so young would not conclude his term of office, that death would interrupt. There is very little else to report here in Washington, just the general reactions from... Oh, and a bulletin had just come in from Dallas. A sniper armed with a high-powered rifle murdered President Kennedy today, according to the Associated Press Dispatch. Oh, here barely 2 hours after Kennedy's death, Lyndon Johnson has taken the oath of office as the 37th President of the United States. So it is President Lyndon Baines Johnson, 55 years old, the new President of the United States. Now, back to New York.
There are details on the swearing-in of Lyndon B. Johnson as President of the United States. The oath was administered in Dallas at 1:38 Central Standard Time. That would be roughly an hour and 20 minutes ago, by a federal district judge, Sarah T. Hughes. President Johnson took the oath aboard the presidential plane at Love Field in Dallas as he prepared to fly to Washington to take over the presidency. This is the oath that was administered to Mr. Johnson. I do solemnly swear that I will faithfully execute the office of President of the United States and will do the best of my ability to preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States. That is all we know about the swearing-in of Lyndon Johnson as the 36th President of the United States. Mr. Kennedy's predecessor, General Eisenhower, has issued this statement here in New York on the assassination of the President. Quote, I share the sense of shock and dismay that all Americans feel at the despicable act that resulted in the death of our nation's president. Mrs. Eisenhower and I also join with all other citizens in expressing our personal grief and prayerful concern to Mrs. Kennedy and all other members of the family. The statement issued on behalf of General Eisenhower here in New York this afternoon. Frank?
Well, the... Moscow Radio is playing funeral music after announcing the death of President Kennedy, and all diplomats in the Russian capital are described as being aghast. And the United States ambassador to Russia, Foedy Kohler, told of the news, and his response was to say, it's terrible, terrible. Moscow Radio quoted reports, and this is Moscow Radio now, assuming that extreme right-wing elements were believed responsible for the assassination. News of the president's death by a bullet in the head was immediately passed on to the top Soviet figures, this according to Russian sources. No reaction directly from the Kremlin was expected until tomorrow. Russian television broke into its late-night programming to announce the assassination, and the Soviet news agency TASS reported from New York here that, quote, an attempt was made on his life by persons believed to be among extreme right-wing elements. Of course, later they were informed that the president was dead. A heart-clutching thought to think of those two children in the White House, the son and the young daughter. And we can only assume, of course, that they have been informed of their father's death. Regardless of what one may have thought about the Kennedys as a political institution in the United States, they were regarded by all as being terribly vivacious and vital people who were quite alive. The situation at the moment is that the President John F. Kennedy is dead. His body is believed to be en route, or shortly will be en route, back to Washington. It's expected to arrive from Dallas at Andrews Air Force Base outside Washington about 5:30 Eastern Standard Time today, which is about an hour and a half from now. The new president of the United States, Lyndon B. Johnson, has been sworn in by a federal judge in Dallas and is remaining for the moment in Dallas. The president's brother, the Senator Ted Kennedy, and a sister, the wife of Sergeant Shriver, are on their way to Otis Air Force Base in Massachusetts. The family, of course, comes from Boston, and it is assumed that they're going there to be with the parents of the president. The last word we had on Mrs. Kennedy was that she was at the hospital where the president died. She probably is not at the hospital now, but we do not know where she is. Her privacy is being respected as well as it should be under these circumstances. Mrs. Johnson is no doubt with the new President Johnson. And that is the situation that we have it at the moment. And do you have some more information, Bill?
Only, Frank, that there was word that Mrs. Kennedy had, in fact, left the hospital.
I see.
With the body of the president, presumably to go to Dallas's Love Field, from which place the body would be flown back to Washington for the state funeral, which will follow. Preparations for that, we understand, are already being tentatively made by military experts who would handle the affair. They are gathered at the White House.
Did we want to go to this
morning? I believe so, Frank, yes.
We have prepared some material on some of the last appearances that President Kennedy was able to make. In what has proved to be his last formal speech, the late President John Fitzgerald Kennedy commented to a dinner in Houston, Texas last night.
Excuse me, Frank.
Yes.
Excuse me, Frank, but I'm told not ready.
All right.
We'll just handed it.
And we'll have it for you in a moment, then.
If I can, I will attempt a chronology of what happened today. The president was in Dallas on a five-city, two-day sweep of the state. He had his wife with him, her first active campaigning, and it supposedly was to look forward to what she would be doing next year in his expected presidential campaign. The president had made at least one speech in Dallas and was on his way to a trade center to make another when a sniper's bullet hit him in the head. It took 5 minutes for the motorcade to dissolve sufficiently so that the president could be driven to the hospital. He was driven to the Parkland Memorial Hospital in Dallas. When he was brought in, doctors said that his condition was moribund, that is, close to death, but he was unconscious. The wound, from the descriptions they have given, was massive, and apparently nothing that medical science could do could make any change in his condition. He died in approximately a half hour from the time he sustained the wound. The first word that came of the president's passing came from two Roman Catholic priests who had been summoned to the hospital to administer to him the last rites of the Roman Catholic Church. Riding in the car with the president, in addition to his wife, was Texas Governor John Conley and his wife. Neither of the ladies was injured, although Governor Conley did sustain, we are told, three wounds, one in the chest, one in the wrist, and an extremely minor one in the leg. He has undergone surgery, apparently for removal of the bullet which struck him in the chest. He is said to be in reasonably good condition, but there is the qualification left that he is not yet out of the woods. That is roughly what we know of what happened today in Dallas. There is no indication that the sniper or snipers has been found. One person has been taken into custody in the city of Dallas, but that is in connection with the killing of a Dallas policeman. Policemen and Secret Service agents who fanned out from the area where the attack on the president took place on a freeway have found a rifle. And now for a late report from Fort Worth, Dallas, we go to station WBAP-TV and newsman Charles Merkin.
Here now are late, unedited, unscreened films of the shooting scene in Dallas. This was a scene near the Stemmons Expressway. This is in front of City Hall in downtown Dallas, a mile east of the shooting scene. Heavy crowds line the downtown streets to view the presidential party. As in all of the Texas stops, there were many teenagers affected there by the First Lady and the President. This is Main Street in Dallas. Is this moving west? This is moving west toward the fatal moment. The motorcade is traveling at about 20 to 25 miles an hour, slowly westward down Main Street in the heart of Dallas. The time
About 12:20, during the noon hour, heavy crowds of downtown officers lining the route. That looks like the school depository building on the right. I'm not sure. This is the scene of confusion. Something has happened here. The cameraman running toward the scene for the presidential car ahead of him. We caught just a blurred glance of the old school depository building from which the sniper fired the shot. This is the reaction from the crowd. All is confusion at the scene. Here a woman shelters herself. Now racing toward the hospital. On Stimmons Freeway, past the trademark to the right where the president was to have spoken, where he was to have criticized the fanatical right. There, okay. That is Parkland Hospital, 1.5 to 2 miles from the shooting scene. Parkland Hospital, where the president died and died. By the time these films were shot, of course, the presidential car was already at the hospital. This is Major General Clifton, the military aide of the president, press secretary going into the hospital. These pictures, this is General Clifton. This is the emergency room entrance of Parkland Hospital in Dallas. Later films, as they are developed, and as they arrive here, will be shown. This is Charles Murphy reporting from WBAP-TV, Fort Worth, Dallas.